I said I love trans people.
Wow.
That makes it okay now.
A little too much.
So,
shout out to Angelica. She's trying to keep up. Trying to keep up with me. I know. You're going to hear a lot of insulting things.
Technically, give that a round of
trans people in the community. But actually, do it, actually. I really do, actually.
All right, well, I'm going to give my score now. So far, these four episodes, I'm going to give it a solid 8.5. I think it was good.
Lowest
It was definitely good.
Just wait.
Yeah, I'm impressed so far, but I feel, it could be a little bit.
Ice Cube.
You know, bring some more to it. So, let's hit them comments up. Let's see what we got.
Oh, you don't want to hit these comments. You want to hit these comments?
Sure.
Oh, okay.
That's why I just asked.
Let me start from the
it's
top.
Bobby.
Oh, it's Bobby.
Here we
Bobby's
go.
Dumb
it's
ass.
David.
Oh,
it's,
here we go.
Oh, it's Blake. I hadn't even talked to Blake since high school, and this guy is just wanted to jerk me off, man.
That's a lot
why?
Of dick jerking.
I know.
You should at least do Dutch runner.
Blake.
Hey, he's trying to experiment. He didn't get to in high school.
I know. I think that's what it was.
That's what the college years are for.
Do the Dutch runner.
Well, he never went to college.
Well, he never went to college. Yeah. That's, well, that's his midlife crisis right now.
It's a possibility.
Well, he's,
should we do it on camera?
The Dutch runner?
No, no. Exactly. Get Aruba jerked off on camera?
No. Okay. That wouldn't... that's a whole different streaming.
That's a whole different show.
I'm not trying to get us banned. Or
yeah, we, I like to keep the Facebook channel like...
All right, then let's move on to the next review then. I mean,
not oh, banned.
That's when DeFool and Friends joins Pornhub.
But, right. no, we
have our own channel.
We got some comments here. Right.
I want these comments.
We have this show, and then we have the late night show. You know what I'm saying? After the show. The show after the show.
The full friends party. After dark.
After dark. No. If we're doing it, it's the full and friends at night.
Late night.
It was already at night, though.
Yeah.
Late night.
Yeah,
was it like Nick night. At night?
Yeah, I know. What is this? Nick
Dick at night.
Does that mean you're Nick Cannon? Dick Cannon?
The full and friends Dick at night.
Let's get some toothless whores in here, feed them some meth, and have a time! Sorry. Shout out to Aruba's parents.
Love you, mom. Love you, dad.
Right after talking about whores and meth.
I know.
I apologize.
All right, let's man get these comments, please.
Oh, man. It's just about jerking off. Blake wants to know how come we don't talk about jerking off too much. Lauren wants to know, hey, talked about Death Stranding yet. I don't know what that means.
That's a game.
That's a game.
Okay. Bobby, hey, midget porn.
Right, of course.
Oh, and then Blake.
Hey, that should have used a listener. Bro.
I know. That's right. Yeah. And then Blake comes back around, Death Stranding this dick.
Okay. Right?
Yeah, so it's going to get dirtier.
Dude, I love our audience.
I know. You guys are such.
You guys are the winners.
I guess the theme of this episode is dick.
Dick stroking.
Oh, man.
Not just dick. Dick stroking.
So, right. Oh, so then I commented, hey, so why don't you just come over here and get your hand off your dick?
God, why would you do that? And don't give him the address.
I don't have the address.
Don't
and
do
I
that.
Said, damn, 1, 2, 3, 4, Handy Lane.
Did you just clap the emoji?
No, I did. He just ghetto clapped at the
I ghettoed
it.
Get your ass over here.
Wow.
Syllables.
I don't think it's a good idea to let them in here.
No, that's not happening.
So I gave him an address.
They're goddamn animals.
1, 2,
I love
four,
them, but no.
Handy Lane.
I'm just going to play this well in the background.
If they come over, we're never going to do the reviews. It'll never happen.
The reviews won't happen. There'll be a bunch of other shit, probably.
Right. This won't be a DeFool and Friends
episode. I'm not
trying
to get banned off Facebook.
And then Laura wanted to know when if you were going to go to the Renaissance Festival.
I'm about that life. I'm going to interview some Renaissance Festival people. It's going to be fun. I don't know about that. I'll be done by the fucking halfway through the first one.
And then Blake Benson. Look at me. Look at me.
Look at me.
I'm the captain.
I'm the one jerking off now.
I knew it. I said, look at me.
And I said, look in the mirror, motherfucker. You ain't looking at me.
Oh, damn. Y'all jerk each other off.
Oh.
Yeah. They
look in the mirror, motherfucker.
They are definitely...
I said, look in the mirror. Not look at me.
Oh.
Mirror, motherfucker. Look at me. Look in the mirror.
I feel like you would enjoy that.
Oh, I thought you were saying jerk you off. I would.
And Angelica's
Jesus
asking me,
Christ.
I'll bring back the Thriller. She wants me to bring back the Thriller jacket. It's too hot for the Thriller jacket.
Yeah. He's been bitching about it. Like, don't put him
through
that.
They don't have fans in here. They're first thing, like, you know, I don't have OSHA come in here.
What happened to the fan? There was a fan in here.
It's over by me.
Oh.
I'm crisp over here.
Yeah, he has a nice.
I got all the equipment, all right? Like,
douche.
The fuck? What'd you expect? Oh, there's candy over here, too. Ooh, so, check it out. Second review. This music has nothing to do with it. I just felt like listening to Boondock Saints theme. Let's listen to the Boondock Saints theme for a second.
Bobby, five guys jerking off. Those are kind of low viewers, bro.
Right?
100? That's it?
You better put that shit on Pornhub and get at least a couple thousand
viewers. We're trying to hit 900 right now.
Right.
Oh. Right.
Again, thank y'all for that.
I'm trying to push 100. I'm trying to push
875 in our last episode. So, all right. Second review. Dumb and Dumber. No, wait. No, we're saving that for last. They come for us at night.
They come at
the night comes for us.
The night comes for us.
The night comes on us.
What's funny is I had to sit there and go.
The night is coming.
No.
On your face.
The night is. Oh, damn, man, we're doing this.
The night comes on us.
Dude, why are there two champagne?
It's gonna be one of those episodes, huh?
There's two champagne glasses sitting there. Are those champagne.
It's
those,
for the night when it comes.
It's because that's,
on us.
That's this is the champagne room. That's you know. There's no.
That's
sex
the casting couch.
There's no sex in the champagne.
All right,
room. Right. There's a real couch over here.
Mm.
Yeah.
So the night comes for us.
I recommended it.
Big Red recommended it.
Great martial arts.
It's
man.
A martial arts slash action film.
It's modern. It's an Indonesian movie.
Yeah.
Which is, I think they're different from Hong Kong movies as far as
I'm concerned.
Yeah, I agree.
No, and I got some things I'm going to point out, or if you point out, I'm going to agree, because there's some things that I'm like, interesting.
It's just super
But
dark
it's you picked it, so you know how we do here. Go ahead.
Like Hong Kong, Jackie Chan style stuff, like where there's like some goofy stuff, there's a little bit of comedy. Not so much in these movies.
Right.
This is kind of like akin to The Raid and The Raid 2.
Mm-hmm.
I think they substitute comedy for gore.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Which I'm fine
Jinx.
With.
Jinx.
They do. And they, I mean,
you guys are so cute. Pretty much.
I knocked down one.
And yeah, like they Don't do actually. Coke. There's some moments that are like so outrageous that you're like, that's funny.
Right.
Right.
So like they kind of do play comedy up like that. Super fucking violent.
It really was.
I mean, the gore. It's like. The Raid is much better with the choreography, in my opinion. But
okay.
The gore.
Yeah.
Like, the gore level is so fucking through the roof.
Yeah.
That it makes up for it, in my opinion. And I actually prefer it a tad to The Raid.
And
because of that. I think it's, I mean, the story
is. I mean,
because
it is what you're looking for.
The Raid 2 is great, man. But, like, there's so much plot going on.
Right.
And it slows it down a little bit for me. Whereas this one is just straight, like, there's a few moments where you calm down for a second and you flash back. There's a few flashbacks, like back when they're hanging out.
Right, know, right. To like, kind of explain
like
the story a little
5
bit.
5 minutes, yeah. Like, they right. do that a little bit. But most of the time, man, it's just like big action sequences.
Right.
A whole lot of, I mean, dude. And like, The Raid was more like, you know, hand-to-hand combat. This incorporates a little bit more knives.
Right.
Anything that could be a weapon.
Right.
Yeah, anything, dude. When
basically.
He uses, a when bone. He uses the, it's like, what's that sign say?
The wet floor sign.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The fact it's metal is weird, but
I think it's hilarious that they consider that to be a white boy. I think it's hilarious. I'm like,
well, I think Bobby. What it was is just more a play on the fact that he was a druggie and shit.
Yeah.
Because I think the That's other true, culture's right. view of us, one where fat people
and apparently violent and
motor scooters with the flag and guns. That's like everybody's outside views mostly when they're being, you know, stereotypical
what?
American.
People think of us as violent?
Yeah, exactly.
Is that
I'm
why,
shocked.
Is that why I love the Bobby character so much?
Right. I mean, because he is the...
awesome.
He was the junkie.
He was kind of a badass in a way.
In a sense, yeah. He was the junkie that redeemed himself, you know?
Yeah.
Because he did redeem himself at the end. Well, not end, but middle, I guess. That was like the middle scene.
Yeah. I think he's the one that got him into the mess, if I read it right. Because, like...
Yeah. Well...
He got into it. He probably owed some people some money.
Well, no, more so... No, the more so there after Ito. Ito.
No, I know, but like before that. Like when they flash back and they're like, he's like, you got us into this shit.
Oh, yeah. Got him deeper with the triad.
Yeah, exactly. Because
of the
yeah.
drugs.
And yeah. like they had to appease a triad
mm-hmm.
to like basically for what he did. You know what I'm
And then after that point, they were in too
yeah,
deep.
Exactly.
Like
and
any
Ito
mob.
Followed it and what's the other guy's name? The guy, the Chinese.
Faith?
Fatih.
Well, his name is Faith.
It's Fatih.
But it's Faith. I said Faith on the screen. I know it's Fatih, but it says faith, faith. I gotta have faith, faith.
It says faith on the screen?
Yeah.
Yeah, it did.
Baby!
F-A-T-I-H. Fatih. Yeah, it looks like because the letters are so close.
Sounds like
I'm telling you, it's Fatih.
Sounds like Reds have dyslexia over here.
No, dude. Like they well, because like, if you listen to them talk to him, when they talk to him, they go Fatih. I listen to that shit.
Needs it's Fatih. Time.
Life gives him.
Check it out, viewers. I'm the one that's right.
Emotion.
Anyway,
got to pick my heart up.
Yeah, not Fatih. Fatih was pretty Ricky with the hair. Fucking.
This is the guy with the purple shirt. He was pretty boy. He was the one that was fucking homeboy's girl after he left.
I know, that was weird. Like, you don't get the backstory on that at all.
No, just that it happened. Yeah. You knew that it happened because like, the whole, shit, he grabbed her hand like, yo, you need to go because shit's about to get real.
Yeah.
And man,
I love that they didn't dig into that. They just kind of like let it be. It's like,
well, you knew what it was, but they were like, man. Yeah. But I mean, because what is there to explain? Homeboy left. She just says, she's like, we thought y'all, you were dead or you gone forever. So yeah, she moved on and was fucking his best friend.
It's Walking Dead shit.
Life.
Yeah. And life. Walking Dead and life.
That's fucking how life works, you know? You leave for 3 years and they start fucking your best friend.
I wanna
Bo, you okay?
No.
Who hurt you, bro?
Right.
Who hurt you? Who hurt you? Tell me!
What the
It's fucking life, this movie.
It's fucking real.
You gotta murder motherfuckers.
Murdering whole villages.
I actually want to go back and rewatch that movie just to get a total death count in there and see how many people died.
Oh my god.
Yo!
The way bodies just like.
It's up there with the Rambo movies.
The way body parts would just be like. Falling to the ground like fucking rocks.
No, I did like, by the way, how there was a fight scene later on, like after everybody got shot and killed, the bodies were still there later on.
Yeah.
Which actually gave a bit of consistency to the movie.
Exactly. Right. No, he didn't come up and clean up after him.
It was.
Like death didn't just show up like exactly. Oh, fuck.
Like most movies, it's like they film it afterwards kind of thing and you forget that it even happened because the bodies weren't there.
Right.
This actually gave that bit of realism to it.
Mm-hmm.
No, I shouldn't say realism because that movie's not realistic. Not
right, but the idea.
Yeah, the idea of it, right. Yeah,
I mean,
they would have been cleaned up.
That's how I feel about the most recent Nightmare on Elm Street remake from like 2010. Like they put a little bit more realism into what happens when you don't sleep.
Bro, that was as far back as 2010.
Yeah.
Was it that long ago?
No.
The Jackie Earl Haley one? Yeah. Dude.
No way.
Holy yeah, shit. It was 2010. Pretty positive, dude.
I mean, I trust you because that's your shit, but
dude, like the thing is,
like it's been
what I loved about it is they focused on the reality of sleep deprivation.
Right.
Not the fact that, yeah, this is fake, but the fact that this is what happens when people don't get sleep. You start seeing shit because you're micro-napping. Your brain starts shutting down for a little bit to try to recoup.
Yeah.
And you're stuck between like seeing your dreams in real life.
You'll start hallucinating.
Yeah, and that's why I loved how they touched on that in the movie. Like that movie went super dark, which is why it did not do too well, because everybody wants to preach about pedophilia and shit, but when they do a movie about a fucking serial killer, they're like, whoa, hey,
weird, yeah.
Reel it in. Because they never really focused that on in the original series. He was a child killer, but not a molester. But they never really delved into it.
Yeah.
They went more of the slight, funnier route of him being, his kills were kind of funny and shit. But I like when movies do that, when they, some elements of reality are there as grandois or grandoisie. Is that how you think?
Grandoisie. Yeah. I've heard that.
As much of a, show it is. It's still got some pieces that you can be like, oh, yeah, that shit's
what?
Real.
What is it?
Funky Buddha?
Funky Buddha?
Floridian? The whippier.
I want one.
Yeah?
Yeah,
all
right, man.
So,
all you gotta do is ask, bro.
We're at the point where we're gonna.
Florida?
I want you to give me your favorite scene from the movie.
Oh, my God. Dude, probably the meat locker scene because.
Yeah, you were. Yeah,
the butchers?
Yeah. Well, actually. I'll say that scene because that's when you knew, like when he picks the homeboy up and he puts him on the meat hook.
Yeah,
you gonna throw that shit?
Don't do that. That's a bad idea. I felt like that was a bad idea.
I'm a goddamn fucking.
All right,
Randy Moss.
I'll take that.
When he picks him up and he puts him on the meat hook, like I was like, that's when I remember the first time I watched it. I'm like, this shit's gonna be fucking crazy.
Right.
I'm really sorry. Because, like, you see what's his name?
Ito?
Not Ito, but the guy that he faces at the end.
Oh, his buddy.
Yeah.
When
he's in the
Arian?
Nightclub.
Arian.
He's Arian? In the nightclub, and he's trying to please that triad dude. And, like, he, you know.
Triad?
Or triad.
Triad?
Triad. Triad. I'm sorry.
Fucking this triad. Guy over here. He's talking to this fucking guy over here.
Triad.
You got the fucking triad.
Come on.
The fucking mafia over here.
How did we turn into Italian?
Fucking the mafia.
I just went with it. I just went with it.
Fucking this guy over here.
Hey.
This fucking triads. What is he, triaging? In the fucking hospital?
No, it's funny. That's what I mixed it up with. Fucking triage. I used to deliver those forms, dude.
Fucking so doing surgeries. But yeah, you were saying the meat locker. And,
oh, yeah. Like when, dude, that whole fucking, like, oh, everything with the saw and all that shit. Face. Are you okay?
Yeah, no, I'm good.
With the saw and everything.
Whole fucking world,
yeah. I mean, like,
I don't know how to pawn headphones.
I mean, it's just so
I'm
going to
make a gif of that.
Okay. And what about, what's your score?
I judge movies for what they try to be. I want to preface with that.
Oh, okay. I like that.
This score is going to be pretty stupid high.
Because some people, they go like, well, it's not for me or whatever. That's why Cowboy Bebop, like, I rated it way higher than I actually enjoyed it, to be honest.
Right.
But I understand, you know what I'm saying, like, that it's well made. It's like, for this, like, they're going for a certain niche of people. Like, it's not, like, for everybody.
Niche.
So, and I'm of that niche.
Niche.
And
my niche.
Dude, I give it, honestly, dude, I give it a 9.6.
Damn.
Yes. I think it's incredible. Dude, the whole time, I'm glued to my fucking chair. I'm sitting there watching it. I'm not looking away. You know what I'm saying? And to me, like, that's the sign of a good movie. It engages. You're engaged. You know? It's immersive. You're in it.
Stop using these big words on me, bro.
I'm not using big words.
Immersive.
You scared of these big words?
Dude, I won't even remember these words.
I know.
You right, gotta rewatch some of these.
This guy's gonna get too deep over here.
All right.
We even remember these words?
So, Chuck.
It's very, very good and a lot of
that's
you're up next.
I did look up the synopsis before I watched it, so I had a general idea. However, it doesn't live up to how awesome the movie actually was.
Right.
I was not... I didn't know what I was getting myself into. I was thinking... Because the way you said it last episode was like... You said Kung Fu.
Right.
And I was thinking You did.
Yeah.
And I was thinking like a Kung Fu movie, like a traditional one.
Yeah.
But it's like a gory...
I'm fucking around, to be honest.
It's more like a gory action movie with...
Right.
More like a gory action movie with...
Come
here, my train of thought
altogether. Come here, honey.
I just struggled over the
daddy. Open it for you, buddy. Here you go.
Thank you, Dad.
There you go, buddy.
Thank you.
There you go.
My medicine.
Hey, enjoy it.
It's a gory action movie with some martial arts.
Dude, I literally just clipped my nails. That actually hurt, man. I was like,
You okay over there, buddy?
Little baby nails.
You good?
Yes. Dude, that shit's like good.
So, Chuck, what's your favorite scene, Matty?
I don't know if I have one in particular.
You got it.
That was tough.
You know how we do this show.
How about the scene where he gets captured by the mob, basically, police mob, whatever. And
the triads.
They're in the fucking... The triads. And they're in the fucking armored vehicle, and he pulls the guy's grenade and pushes it back.
That's an awesome scene.
I love how you're giving him his scene.
The way to
like, this is your favorite. I promise.
Don't worry, I got this for you.
I didn't mention this scene myself.
So I'm going to mention it for you.
This is your second favorite scene.
This is how you
are. Second favorite scene.
That was an
favorite.
Awesome scene, though.
It really was. Awesome.
The way the body parts fell, dude, I was like, wow.
That's a tough call.
Yeah.
It really is.
What's the one that stuck out with you the most?
I kind of like the scene where Ito and I can't remember the other guy's name, his friend, that they were...
Arian,
when they're fighting it out.
That's weird. I forget his name, too.
Yeah, right? It's weird. He's there.
He's the Wu assassin.
And then he disappears.
Because
they
say
again.
His name, like, twice, I think. Like,
he's the Wu assassin. Yeah, you know that show, Wu Assassin, on Netflix?
He's one of the six C's.
Dude, Arian, though, is cold-blooded.
But you know, like, can we talk? Hold on. Wu Assassin on Netflix. That's him.
I have no idea what that is.
I watched the first episode, and I was like, eh. I never watched it again.
I think pretty much all these people in the
raid. Yeah, a lot of them are. But yeah, that fight scene was fucking...
It was pretty intense. They're like stabbing each other at the end.
Brutal, bro.
Arian, I always forgot his name already. Arian stabs Ito in the face with the fucking box cutter and the razor blade just sticking out the side. Yeah. And he just Ito just bites the thing off the plastic and spits it out.
Dude.
Plus the very end scene.
Oh, yeah, when he's got in the car?
That grin. Holy shit.
Yeah.
That grin he does, like, he just looks like,
fuck yeah!
Pure mania.
Real anime.
So, did you ever play through Red Dead Redemption?
The first one. Not the second one.
Did you finish it, though?
Yeah.
So, remember the ending?
Vaguely. It was years ago.
When he walks out the barn?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It's totally
that,
it. Yeah.
That. So, very Red Dead Redemption, the game, at the end, that's basically their ending.
It's very Bonnie and Clyde.
Yeah. You basically open up in the barn in Red Dead, and the whole fucking sheriff squad's there. And you, as playing the game, you can take out a couple of them, yeah, but they all waste you. And that's the end of the game.
Yeah.
I was just like, and so that's immediately what I thought of when I saw
Devil's Rejects, personally.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, but that's immediately what I thought of when I saw that scene when he was just basically starting the car, like, yeah, I'm about to roll these motherfuckers over. I'm taking one of you with me.
Just that grin looks so, like, menacing, weirdly sardonic, and at the same time just like, I don't give a fuck anymore.
Coming out over here.
Right? Very, you know.
I didn't even hear him, man.
Sardonic.
Sardonic.
Look it up.
That's a very solid word.
I'm going to have to look it up.
I feel like if you played that on the...
you know how I'm going to spell that?
Scrabble board. Might be some points involved in that, bitch.
Satanic.
Sardonic, satanic. Same thing. Not really.
But yeah, no, he had that look of just like kind of peaceful.
It's just, I don't know, it was very like... I don't know, it'll stick with me for a while, but yeah, he was pretty awesome. Him and Arian were both awesome at martial arts, though.
Yeah, they went in. They went in.
I was surprised with that movie. I liked it a lot more than I thought I would, to be honest.
Yeah, it was... that's one of those that I kind of wish I would have had a dub, just because I wanted to focus solely on the action.
But there were English parts.
Which, that was the other thing that was kind of
threw me off, because it's like, it's all in Indonesian.
Right.
And then there's a random English parts.
Right. English parts are actually worse for me, because I'm like, there's no English subtitles for what he's saying, and I can barely understand what he's saying.
I understand clearly. You're racist.
No, like the first part, the first time, it was, what's that guy's name? Chen Wu?
Chen Wu.
Yeah, Chen Wu.
Chen
Wu. The 7C guy?
Yeah. Or Chen Wu.
6C or 7C?
6Cs.
6Cs. The 6C guy, the other guy.
Chen Wu.
Kind of a stupid name, though.
Dude, that was a... He was
the
a
wolf?
I'll be honest.
No, 6Cs. It's not fun to say at all.
6Cs. No, it's not, but it's dope.
Yeah.
I like it. Like, I thought it was dope. I was like, the 6Cs? Okay. That's kung fu.
Oh, yeah, that's why the homeboy was like...
I'm taking over your spot.
Right. It's not revealed till a little bit later in the movie that Ito is one of the six C's, which is basically a guardian of the triad's drug trade.
Right.
Yes.
You know.
Which means you bad as fuck.
Pretty much.
All right, Chuck, what's your score?
Going in with no expectations, being very pleasantly surprised, a lot more gore than I was expecting, which honestly I don't care. It's whatever.
Right.
Did you like that beer?
I'll probably give it like it's 8.9.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. And Aruba, you totally did not watch this.
Nope, I didn't.
You got to go back and watch it.
Yeah, yeah, bitch.
It's about 2 hours. Totally worth it.
I probably won't. But yeah, thanks.
Dude, you'll sit there. I'm telling you, if 30 minutes in, you could turn it off. Like, I don't think you can.
I'm gonna watch it tonight.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do it.
No, you won't.
No, I won't.
Just do it at some point. When you're on Netflix, just be like, the night comes for us.
Like, you're not doing it.
And then he's going
to I want to. The Let's intention is there.
He's
going to
do
wrong.
That. He's going to be like, ooh, The Office.
Yeah, exactly.
If you, I mean,
ooh, Mark, the other guys.
Think Jackie Chan. Ooh,
BoJack Horseman.
Yeah. The other guys.
Sorry, I hate Will Ferrell.
I know.
What? I hate Will
You
Ferrell.
Hate Will Ferrell?
I like a
that
few
national treasure.
There's a lot of people that do. Bro.
What, dude?
I'm sorry, but when he improvs, he's fucking terrible. Because he's just reaching. He's trying so hard. When he sticks to a script, I like him, but I do not like when he improvises.
Chuck, I'm not with you on this. I'm usually with you on everything.
I hate Will Ferrell.
What the fuck?
Yeah. Man, I like John C. Reilly. When I first found this out, I was like, I don't know if we're going to be able to be friends.
I love John C. Reilly, though. John C. Reilly is the shit.
I'm glad you brought it out later.
Right. Now that we're friends. Because this might have been a deal breaker.
Because honestly, in the beginning, I'd probably be like,
you're a piece of shit.
I just don't like him personally.
Now,
like
my buddy,
I love John C. Reilly. He's fucking hilarious.
Watch, Eastbound and Down, or is that what it is?
No, that's David McBride. But
Danny
McBride, where he's like the bloopers, where he's like, I can't even fucking say it, dude.
You can't say it.
I will say a few things.
No, I mean, like, I can't say it without laughing.
I give Will Ferrell a little bit of slack. Anchorman is awesome. But I think it's also because he's surrounded by a ton of good people, and the writing is on point in the directing.
True.
That's a good one.
Dude, he's all improv.
He was surprisingly good in Stranger Than Fiction. I was surprised in that one.
Yeah, that was good.
And I like his small bits he does here and there. Like in Wedding Crashers, but when he was like Chaz, stuff like that. I like his small parts.
You didn't like, you didn't like the other guys or Step Brothers?
The other guys are great. Step Brothers are
I
great.
I like Step Brothers for John C. Reilly.
Hmm.
And everybody else is good in that movie, too.
The bro, other guys, though? Fucking other guys.
I laughed once in the other guys.
Bruh, him and Wahlberg? Fucking Wahlberg?
The only scene that got me...
I want to know this.
Aim for the Bushes. It's the
that wasn't even the beginning!
I know. I fucking hate Will Ferrell. He's awful.
Even when he's a tuna?
Other guys was
he's
so terrible.
When he's a tuna!
This is a take you should keep to yourself.
Well, it's out there now on Facebook.
Dude, Talladega Nights?
Oh, once again.
It's
great
like,
cast. I love the cast around him.
Dude.
I didn't like it's like telling people you're into midget porn or something. You just keep it.
We've come full circle.
Exactly.
There it is.
We're going to give that a fucking round of applause right there. We've come full circles, ladies and gentlemen. Midget porn. Come back.
He's turning in right
dude,
now.
Dude, watch the Eastbound and Down blooper reel with Will Ferrell. It's fucking.
Was he like a regular in that
and
show?
It's all
or
improv.
Was...
Huh?
Before we move on, was he a
well,
regular?
Well, I
got to
do mine.
No, it wasn't a regular. He was, I don't think.
We're not moving.
Or just
on.
Like a random like, appearance.
Dude, I don't know. Okay. Honestly, I don't even know the episode, but I watch that blooper reel and I fucking cry every time I watch it.
I was just curious because I've never seen the show. Yeah. Yeah. I was just wondering.
Don't
so.
I'm talking like cry when I watch it, bro. Like, it's so funny to me you don't like him.
Okay. Oh. So, for me, I was pleasantly surprised. When you said Kung Fu, I really thought it was Kung Fu.
I can't believe I said that.
It was not Kung Fu. It was close, but it wasn't Kung Fu.
I was probably fucking around with y'all.
Well, you were pretty fucking annihilated.
Yeah.
But I will say this. I was still happy with it. I was very impressed by it. As simple as a story as it was, I was impressed. I will say, I thought the I don't know if it was something with the sound, the fights, the punches. I feel like in some of the other action films, like there's one that Donnie Yen did called Flashpoint, where it's a kung fu movie, but it's also like an actual story. He's an undercover cop, or his buddy is, and he's a cop. They're both cops. One's undercover, kind of dealing with a little bit of the triad and shit.
Is it parted?
But the fight scenes were like. Fucking brutal, like, and you hear it in this. It, like, you see how visceral it is, but it doesn't sound visceral. If that makes sense, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the violence was done really well.
It was done well, but I feel like the sound wasn't as good. It's really weird. It's
low budget as fuck. You can tell.
Yeah, like the fight with
but it
Ito
looked better than some
and,
American
movies,
to be honest.
And in some,
dude, that's Indonesians, man.
But the fight with him, Ito and Arian at the end.
Shout out to the Indonesians.
Where they
shout out to Indonesia, y'all effective as fuck, man.
They were like that
efficient. Rather,
they were by I'm that efficient. Pole, that beam, and when they punched the beam a couple of times, I've hit a beam on accident a couple of times.
When he kicked it though. That would have shattered his shin.
And but the thing is, the sound was fucking with me.
Jerry Thunder, the sound.
Shout out no, to it, it sounds show. Like it should have been a that, good reference. That it sounds like it should have been a little bit louder, though.
You know what I'm saying? Like I feel like they it was like muffled almost.
Yeah, that thing would ring out for
yeah,
a while.
Like I'm saying, I've hit like beams like that working in a warehouse, like just fucking off, like playing around and shit. And, like, we've, like, because it was cold, you know, hit it. Like, you do stupid shit when you're bored. This is a men thing. I don't know if women chime in. Do you do stupid shit when you're bored? I don't know.
We try to hurt ourselves when we get bored.
But with men, like, we do stupid shit, like, hit each other with shit.
They go on Pinterest and buy dumb shit.
Okay. But, yeah, like, I feel like...
Can I borrow this jacket?
No.
I'm not
so,
any of that.
But other than that, though, I gotta say the presentation of it all, the pacing was good. The story, as simple as it was good. I loved each and every fight scene. They were all brutal and awesome.
Agreed.
Shout out to fucking White Boy.
White Boy Bobby.
Fucking White Boy Bobby. Bobby! Shout out to Bobby. Hey, you were in the movie,
it's funny because when he said that, I was like, he's white?
Yeah, that's what I said, too.
Hey, like, when they said Bobby, his first person I thought white. Was Bobby.
Oh, Bobby. Really?
The fuck up.
I think we found the Indonesian Bobby.
Pretty much. He's gonna.
They have dude, similar haircuts.
Yeah. Dude, he's gonna.
I'm just saying.
He's gonna make up for all the wrongs he did.
Just saying. And hey.
That's Bobby, bro.
It's there. He's a very giving person.
He is.
You know? So, but my favorite scene, though, I'm surprised it wasn't mentioned, but it was a three-way fight between the chicks.
Oh.
That was a great scene.
Oh. The reason for me, though, was I think, I don't think we ever got her name. The short haired chick.
With the wire?
No. The one that helped them fight the fight off.
According to IMDb, She's titled as the operator.
The operator?
That's all it says.
Okay. Because, yeah, she never really gave her name.
You're right. Like, kind of nameless.
But she had, like, the sub.
Which is kind of cool in a way.
Yeah, she was dope. And honestly, she was fucking, like.
She should have been Black Widow.
So sexy.
Oh, cool.
I was like.
She should have been an awesome Black Widow.
Her mysteriousness. She coming with the silenced submachine gun and shit.
You see the fucking beam and
shit. Like, she's super cute, too.
Yeah, like I'm saying, she, like, her whole character, like, yeah, she could have been Black Widow. Like, if they were looking for an alternative, like, I could see her doing that. But my thing with her fight between them two chicks, one, how badass it was, because you don't, honestly, until, like, Marvel started doing it with some of these chicks and, let's say, Terminator and Ripley and some of these other women, but you don't see these unless you watch, like, Kung Fu movies where you see these women go at it hard. And I love when they fucking cut her finger and it was, like, hanging on.
Dude.
And she was like, you know what, this finger? Fuck it.
Yeah.
Like
the best part is a second later, the other girl she's fighting, her guts just pop out.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like that was awesome. An anime like, moment too.
It was an anime moment.
You thought that was the worst of that encounter.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, yeah. That was their anime moment right there. That was like when the two sword fighters cling and they go past each other.
That's a weird thing in anime. They don't notice like a body part's missing and they
it's
did,
the effect.
They did that. They did that in One Punch Man, by the way, with Mosquito Girl.
Yeah.
Where like her legs are gone and she doesn't realize it. Is it legs? Yeah.
Yeah,
it was a laser.
Yeah, because she was so focused that she fucked him up.
Yeah, she looks down and she's like, "My legs are gone." Like, and that was kind of like that moment where she's like, "My guts are hanging out." Yeah,
and I loved
it.
I loved that.
It made a noise too, and they when she realized that you hear like a I don't remember the sound like specific. It was like a weird sound, like a I don't know,
like a
something like that. Yeah.
But yeah, like, I love that. I love that scene, that fight like between them.
And when you tell me that, I feel like I failed you.
Did.
I know.
And how she held it down in that hallway with the C4 and all that shit. Like, that was just dope. I was very impressed with that.
Yeah, dude. And that's, once again, the fucking...
The colors.
The
colors, bro.
These bodies go into bits and pieces and the way they fall and shit. I'm like... There's something about that with this movie where I'm like, it is so effective.
And don't tell me that didn't remind you of fucking Bebop. When she had the C4s and the dudes came up and she hit the beep. She hid behind the little corner. Yeah. Like, there was some anime tropes that they did there, which I love that the way they did them. You know, it was... the whole movie itself, how they just were, like, self-aware to the point where, like, yeah, well, this is over the top. This is what we're aiming for.
Right.
This is what we're here for.
I feel like... It was taking itself seriously, but it didn't at the same time.
Right.
Which I can definitely appreciate.
Yeah. Like, the whole idea of protecting the child. Like, that was their go-to to bring you, reel you back in. Like, this is why we're doing this. You know? This is why these people are doing it.
I love when Ito kind of explains why he saved her, or spared her and saved her.
Because
you see that thread of humanity that's still there.
And he wanted to save himself, like you said. Which I thought that was pretty solid.
Crazy, though, about it. Chin Wu was actually kind of right, the Seven Seas guy, where he was telling Aaron, he was like, you know, he just killed his own people, right? Like, these are the people he brought up. And when he saw him, he's like, you think he's a good guy or something, like, because he saved this little girl, like,
right?
He fucking, dude, these people, they were working for him. He turns around and just blasts them all.
Yeah.
You know? It's like...
Yeah, I mean, like, you think he's going to do anything for you?
He's the one that probably ordered the attack on that village, like, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, and it's like, he just, on a whim, was like, you know what, I'm going to save this little girl because her mom is, like, right there dying, like, in front of her.
Yeah.
Fucking dark.
That's
why, Dennis, you gotta watch it, man.
It was bad, man. I'm sorry.
And that's a hell of a way to open the movie.
Yeah.
The
dude, when they open it, it's dark, man. You're like,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, overall, I'm going to have to give it a solid 9. 9 for sure.
Yeah, baby. Fuck
yeah. Definitely going to give that shit a 9 because it definitely did a lot of things you weren't expecting in regards to the fights. But also had a decent little story tied to it because you don't really get that much in some of these kung fu movies. Kung fu. It's not kung fu.
I was expecting...
Well, you got to fuck with me. I don't even remember saying that.
So...
I'm sure you don't remember much of that show.
I think I made that up.
Before we move on to the last review that It's just dumb and dumber. Martial arts. We got some comments, Aruba.
Yeah, we do. Hold on a second. I'm trying to reply right now.
All right. You do that.
You guys can continue.
No. We. I want the comments.
All right. Get off. Okay.
I want the comments.
All right.
Give them to me.
Let me see what we got here.
Now.
We got a lot of people tuning in, tuning out. We got We got Vince Gonzalez. Vince.
Shout out to you.
He's a good guy. Awesome guy.
Love you, Vince.
He's been watching since the very beginning. He's been on.
Since the beginning?
Comic Doc. I can't even say your name. Like, it's. There's vowels and consonants that I don't think they belong together, but I love you, man. You be keeping the comments pretty entertaining. I love you. Thank you very much. Always showing some love. We got Angelica, who wanted me to bring back the jacket, so I brought it back. I'm sweating balls, but this is for you guys. You know, my cousin
balls for you.
You know, my cousin Marcy, she's on right now. She was on at least. Never
shout
mind.
Out to Marcy.
Marcy Romero. You know what? Fun fact. She gave me my temp job that I usually talk in my sets. When I fucking quit Stemco. Fuck Stemco. Stemco and I got my temp job, it was Marcy Romero who gave it to
shout
me.
Shout out so, to you, Marcy.
Shout out to Marcy. Thank you very much. I love you.
You know what? You
to get, the moon
you
and
get,
back.
You get like thank a partial round of applause.
Oh, of course. Yes.
There you go.
She took care of me.
Just a little bit.
What else? What else we got over here? We got a lot of comments, a lot of activities. But for the most part, Angelica, Bobby, he's still jerking off. I love
God
you, bro.
Damn it.
All right, man.
Finish already.
Bro, yeah, I hope you're using some lotion, man. I did some calluses. I'm worried about you, man. I know.
Right?
Yeah.
Jesus,
taking
Bobby. Fucking
Bobby.
Yeah. Only psychopaths don't use
lotion. I know. I think now you're just trying to show off, motherfucker.
Right?
You're just trying to show off. Now you're just trying to show off, all right? All right. We get you. And that's about it.
Just a jerk off comment.
All right, man.
So we're gonna
love you guys.
We're gonna head into this.
That's like all it is.
The last review of the evening
from the good point of jerking off.
Shout out to jerking off dudes out there.
Yeah,
to jerking off the dudes.
Comic Doc. I can't say it. I can't say.
Pretty crazy. That's a lot of jerking off. So Dumb and Dumber.
That's pretty much every dude. Just shout out everybody.
We're gonna review this Dumb and Dumber.
Shout out to everybody that masturbates.
I'm gonna see if we can't get this guy on the phone.
Shout out to Rio Paris masturbation.
Yeah.
True. Yeah.
I met Rio the other day, man, for the first time. Cool guy.
Hey baby,
let's see if he answers.
Hey baby,
let's see if he answers. We're calling the Bodega Pirate. He's probably jerking his dick.
It'll be appropriate at this point.
Exactly. Come on, Jover.
Damn it, I'm hard.
Don't be a bitch.
Pick the fucking phone up, bitch.
Look it. Fucking Bodega Pirate's not answering.
Oh, shit.
Please leave your message.
Oh, I gotta jerk off.
You're leaving a message?
Yeah, we're leaving a message. Of course we're leaving a fucking message. There's the beep. We leave the message now, guys.
Jofer.
Fucking Jofer! I don't know if you can hear the lips smacking over here. But that was Chuck and that was Red. They did that for you.
They were scissoring.
Scissoring.
Oh, no.
Sipping on some scissors.
Scissor my timbers.
Scissor my timbers.
Jump back! You answer the phone when we call you on show night. We wanted your 2 cents on this Dumb and Dumber. You fucking fuck.
Tool bag motherfucker.
You fucking pirate motherfucker.
You motherfucker.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
That's so stupid.
All right.
I would love to receive that voicemail, by the way.
Yeah, right.
I know, right?
Wouldn't we all? All right, Dumb and Dumber. Ruba, you know how the show works. You've been on it. You submitted this shit.
Oh, no. I got to take off my phone.
Let's go ahead and get it on. Right,
didn't
let's
you
fucking do it.
Were you going to do that like 20 minutes ago?
Jesus Christ.
And then I put it back.
Why?
You know,
the fucking viewers
what
wanted
the fuck?
To see it back.
Oh, you're putting it out?
So he's just going to put it back on in like 5 minutes anyway, then.
Damn, you know, it's not like we're doing a show over here.
Ask him to do
anything.
A review and he just walks off,
know,
you know?
That's what I fucking do.
So you picked Dumb and Dumber.
I did.
So let's go ahead and get the show on the fucking road here.
I need some questions or something. Like, I don't know. What do you want me to talk about? I don't
do
know.
You know how we were, do you not know how we're viewing shit here?
Are you new here?
This is episode 18.
Just tell us why you picked it.
Fucking let's talk about it. Let's do it.
Tell us your life story. Start from the
tell
beginning.
Us about it, eh?
Tell us when your parents conceived.
Whoa, why did you look at me in the eyes when you asked that? That was crazy, bro. God damn, this guy.
Well, he felt that over here.
Yeah. He's genuinely interested.
He was like, tell me when your parents conceived.
Tell me more about your parents.
Tell us everything we need to know about your review of Dumb and Dumber. that reminded me of Drax right there.
When tell me everything in your life up to the point where you saw
Dumb and
Dumber.
Father would talk about impregnating his mother.
So I want to start out. When I saw when did this movie come out, Red? When you know,
1994.
It's 94, yeah. It sounds about
I
right.
I saw this in the theaters.
It is right.
And I want to give my big shout out to my brother, Alex.
He's making shit up.
He fucking took me to this movie. 1994, I was 9 years old. Yeah, what the fuck was I doing in a movie theater at 9 years old watching Dumb and Dumber?
That was a story. My parents took me.
I thank my brother for that shit. I thank my brother. So anyways, it was one of the first comedy movies I ever watched in the theater. It was Dumb and Dumber in Toronto, Canada with my big brother. It holds a special place in my heart. I love it. I do.
And shout out to the Fairley Brothers.
Yes.
Stuck on me.
So, where do I start with this movie? I think it's fucking genius from when I saw it when I was 9 years old to when I saw it, you know, just a couple days ago to review it again. The Farley Brothers are fucking genius. They're hilarious. And when they put Jeff Daniels and Jim Carrey together, I don't know what they were thinking, but it was fucking perfect.
Especially because Jeff Daniels did a lot of serious roles.
Right.
He's going to come out and do a comedy and nail it.
He fucking
killed it. I'm going to do a red fact.
I want to hear red facts.
The reason Jeff Daniels was involved with Dumb and Dumber is because Jim Carrey campaigned for it. And like, I mean, really? he was, dude, super about, like, I'm not doing the movie unless Jeff Daniels is.
Get out of here.
I wonder why, though.
You want to know something, though? Jim Carrey made $7 million making this movie. Guess how much Jeff Daniels made?
I'm guessing nowhere near that.
$600,000.
I was going to say, like, somewhere
in
the
town. You're going to be surprised. Less.
$150,000.
Yes.
$150,000.
Less.
$150,000. What? $75,000.
Less.
What the fuck?
I swear to fucking God, dude.
Yo, he did not make less than
$50,000.
What?
No.
Look it up. Look it up on your phone right now.
No, I'm watching.
Or you look it up. I'm telling you, because if I look it up, it's not going to, you aren't going to believe me.
That's insane.
Dude. $50,000.
Wow.
Why did he take it? Why did he
take
that?
Because, dude, if you think about his career before that, like, he was in a lot of serious roles and really good movies. Like
smaller
Oscar
parts,
contenders,
too.
But, like, this was the movie that really, like, people, the way he put it, he was like, people would come up to me and be like, are you Jeff Daniels? And now it's like, it's Jeff Daniels.
Right.
Like, after,
right.
After Dumb and Dumber, everybody knew.
So he knew the exposure.
He purely did it because he knew Jim Carrey. He's smart as fuck.
Right.
He knew Jim Carrey. He did Ace Ventura and was it The Mask before this?
Probably.
Yeah, I think Mask was like 93. It was too big, huge, and he was on In Living Color.
Yeah.
So he was like really big. But Jim Carrey was smart as fuck because he's like, I need to get a dramatic.
So Jim Carrey picked.
I want to know how
he picked him because he said he wanted to get a dramatic actor that could like actually play alongside him but not like try
That's
to be
insane.
Funny per se.
That's insane.
But like. That's why, like, Jeff Daniels has the better lines, but Jim Carrey is, like, he's so eccentric. And
Right. Yeah. His mannerisms alone just kind of carry that shit. Yeah, yeah, of course.
But, like, Jeff Daniels, he's got, like, the, it's a cardigan, but thanks for noticing. Like,
yeah.
He's got shit like that where it's, like, that's just well-written fucking great gold comedy.
Right.
Yeah.
Some of the writing reminds me of, like, the Zucker Brothers that did, like, Airplane and Naked Gun and all that. It's kind of similar humor.
Yeah, it's a slapstick kind of,
Definitely over the top. It's very Mel Brooksy a little bit.
Yeah. I think he started all that.
He paved the way for it.
I mean, the shit scene itself.
That makes me think why he gave that scene to Jeff Daniels. Yeah. I mean, the characters were there already, but... I mean, that was a fucking hilarious ass scene.
Well, that scene would have not
been
the same.
When I was 9 years old, I was off my seat laughing at that shit, man.
Well, and that scene would not have been the same if it was Jim Carrey. Because Jim Carrey was already known for his ginormous. Are y'all talking about the bathroom scene?
Visuals.
Yeah.
He had one of the biggest personalities at the time.
Yeah.
He absolutely
so for him
did.
To pull off the shit scene, and yeah. Dude, when they're together, like, Jim Carrey's the one that's doing the. What's it called? The physical comedy?
Yeah.
He's kind of doing that thing. And then,
Jeff,
like,
Daniels
Jeff Daniels
is super
is,
subtle.
His is all lines if you really look at it.
That's
like,
true.
I'm going
to like,
I'm gonna start talking to him before I watch a movie.
When he's talking about, like, you know, what do you get when you breed a bulldog with a chit?
Bullshit.
All that stuff is... And what's funny is if you look at Jim Carrey's character, he's the one that gets him into all the shit. You know what I'm saying?
That's true, yeah.
Like, he's the one that's, you know, I got to go to Aspen. And by the way, that's... Oh... I remember reading that the scene where he's like telling him, he's like, you know, I'm sick and tired of having nobody. Like that scene where he's like, actually, it's kind of dramatic.
Kind of.
Where he's kind of like, he's kind of like lament. He's kind of like saying like, you know, I need to take a risk in my life. Like I got to fucking do something. You know what I mean? Like I'm sick of being stuck in this rut.
Yeah.
It actually like feels like dramatic and like a real moment.
True.
He said he wanted to have a dramatic actor alongside him to kind of like make that feel real.
Yeah.
Like Jim Carrey knew what he was doing, man.
Oh no, he's an intelligent man.
Fucking knew.
He's a very intelligent.
I completely forgot that he was in Speed, by the way.
Jeff Daniels, yeah.
Very small role.
Oh, that's right.
But
well,
he's in Speed.
He dies in the one of the first explosions
before
with the
bus even happened.
Yeah, before the bus. I
forgot all about that.
Yeah. I always get him confused with Jeff Bridges.
Completely
what?
Different.
Yeah.
The name Jeff.
Jeff Bridges.
Yeah.
It's the Jeff name.
It's the Jeff.
That's
you
the
got
joke.
Jeffrey.
Shout out to all the Jeffs.
You got Jeffrey.
Right. All right, Ruben, what's your favorite scene from
Favorite scene? I mean, the whole movie is...
But your favorite scene.
Favorite scene. Okay, let me see. If I had to think about it... You know what? I think I love his fantasy that he has with... I don't even know the girl.
Mary Swanson.
Mary Swanson. That's... Samsonite. I was way
off. Swimmy, swampy, slippy. When he said dude, I do that every time. I'm fucking up some word. I'm like slippy, slappy. I do it every time. It's my movie, man.
Oh,
I've never watched a movie more than this, by the way.
Hey, fun fact. What's the laxative that he dumps in?
Turbo lax,
and that's Comic Doc again coming in with the hot facts there. I didn't even know that. I forgot.
What, Turbo lax?
Turbo lax. That's the laxative that he dumps in.
Turbo lax.
Yeah, that's right.
So favorite scene when he imagines that he's gonna go and turn in the briefcase to Miss Swanson.
By the way, he goes to Aspen and it's all sunshine.
And the music.
Like,
and the,
he doesn't even know what Aspen
love
is.
Love is in the air.
Yes.
And he's just going through that whole thing.
She's not wearing panties.
She's not. And he goes in and he's like, and he breaks that fourth dimension. He knows you're watching. He's like doing that for you. He's like, he lifts that dress. He's like, I know you're watching us. Here you go. And I think we've all like daydreamed. And I think I love that scene because he was just so into her. So into that moment that he wanted to make it special, and that's what I mean. Obviously, the whole movie was around was that whole moment of them meeting together, and his imagination of that whole thing. I think that's my favorite scene. His view of that got me.
That shit was hilarious.
That's where the restaurant fight was.
Too. Yeah, the whole restaurant. He had all these different. He had all those different scenarios.
He literally does the Three Stooges bit.
That's prime Jim Carrey right there.
Yes.
Yeah. Play a great shout out to him.
Such a good scene.
I would absolutely love to meet that man and pick his brain.
Who, fucking Jim Carrey?
Jim Carrey?
Yes.
All right. Dude, he's been my idol since like I was a kid, bro.
And he loves Cannibal Corpse, which is
like
awesome.
My thing is
it was in Ace Ventura.
Cannibal Corpse.
That was the band in Ace Ventura, by the way, when he goes into the club.
Yeah.
That was Cannibal Corpse.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Get out of here.
It absolutely was. Hammer Smash Face. That's the song they were playing. He loves Cannibal Corpse.
I just like him because he's funny.
You just blew my mind.
You didn't know that?
But not. He's also very intelligent.
Yeah, they go to the club. That's Cannibal Corpse, yeah.
Oh, my God.
Back when they still Chris Barnes is the vocalist.
And, I always make fun of, whenever I talk about, metal with people, I'll be like, Cannibal Corpse. I don't know. I bring it up just to be...
They're one of the
legends. Like, I act like I know what I'm talking about, but I don't.
I do.
Kick his ass, Seabass.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, man, everyone's...
Oh, that's a great scene.
Everyone is chiming in their scenes right now. So, Angelica is coming in, the scene at the bar. Or the scene at the diner, which is kick his ass, Seabass.
Oh, yeah, yes. Classic.
Throw the salt over your right shoulder.
Right.
He throws the whole thing
over. Jim Carrey gets him into all the shit.
The whole time. Yeah.
The whole fucking time.
That's the whole time.
Yeah.
If you watch it, literally every little thing that happens is because
of Jim Carrey.
That's kind of the thing about the entire thing about their friendship, though. I never really noticed that.
Yeah.
That's a good call.
Yeah, he's the big influencer in the whole fucking thing. Yeah. The whole reason why they go to Aspen.
He's the instigator.
If it was up to Jeff Daniels, man, he'd be like,
hits are falling off.
That whole scene, by the way, bro. The way he delivers that, where he's like, it's my parakeet Petey. He's like, well,
such
what
a pretty bird.
His such head a fell bird. Off.
Dude.
Pretty bird.
Pretty bird. Pretty bird.
That whole scene.
All right, what are you giving it, Dennis?
I love the callback on Pretty Bird, by the way.
The new scene.
I know
hard copy.
What happened?
Hard copy. Boom, boom.
Oh,
no, that was Current Affairs.
He's shit in her bathroom, bro.
Yeah.
But yeah, what's your
Who
score?
Who are these people?
My score on the comedy scale here, I'm going to give it a solid fucking 10.
Oh,
10 out of 10.
Shit.
Dumb and Dumber holds a special place in my heart, man. 10 out of 10.
All right.
You know, it'll have you laughing from the beginning to the end.
Facts.
Watch it. Roll a joint. Watch it. You'll enjoy it.
All
right. Even if you don't roll
that
a joint.
That movie's hilarious. Sober.
Sober. Right. Do it.
Roll a joint anyway. But
yeah. Chuck, you up next.
I remember watching this movie at the Funland Drive-In over off of Hillsborough.
Yes. Oh,
years
shit.
And years ago with my parents. And granted, some of the jokes kind of went over my head a little bit as a kid. I've seen it, I don't know how many times since then. The movie holds up so well.
Yep. Yeah.
Because it's like, they have, the soundtrack is probably the most 90s of it, but the rest of it holds up very well. Which was an excellent soundtrack, by the way. I had that on
cassette.
It's a
great soundtrack.
I had it on cassette. It was really good.
Super 90s.
Yeah, they had like Green Jelly. They had like a bunch of other random songs.
Nah,
you're
doing
it. It was really good. There was even a song. They even had Crash Test Dummies on there, if you remember them.
That's what I was doing.
Oh, it wasn't that song. It was Peter Pumpkinhead, but yeah, that was a good song, though.
The buns on that one.
The song was called Peter Pumpkinhead. You can look it up. It was like one of the first songs on the soundtrack. I remember that because I used to listen to it a lot. But
Butthole Surfers on there.
Yeah, that's right. They were on there. I forgot about that.
I can't even tell you that.
That's like my realization.
But that movie holds up extremely well.
Butthole Surfers.
Butthole.
They're a good band, actually.
They are, actually. But yeah, holds up well.
Continue. It holds up really well. Jeff Daniels does as far as I remember, at least, one of his first big like comedy roles, because he was kind of a serious actor for a while. He had like a lot of smaller parts, and then all of a sudden he did Dumb and Dumber and gets all these bigger roles. But he did awesome in that movie, and I didn't really notice the fact that you, until you pointed it out, Red, that
they made him the funny one, right?
Or was it you that pointed out?
No, him.
Yeah, it's like Jim Carrey was the physical man. Absolutely.
Physical comedy, yeah.
Like, because you can see that's it what with he the ketchup at. That's and him. Mustard scene.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. He slams it down, oh, Jim Carrey, and he's like, and then like, but actually,
peels off.
Jeff Daniels first, and he has him. He just goes, and then like, but when Jim Carrey grabs, he's like, and like fucking, he takes it over the top. But Jeff
I have
Daniels,
a feeling they were just
a...
playing off each other's energy in that scene.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
easily.
Yeah,
but it's like, but Jim Carrey was smart though. He knew he's like, I need a guy that can actually act alongside.
So he went for Jeff. I want to ask you about this, by the way. So he actually went for Jeff Daniels specifically for that role.
Like he I'm pretty sure, fact check me, I'm pretty sure that he said like he wouldn't do it unless he got Jeff Daniels. Like nobody
That's
else.
Interesting.
That's
just because like,
and they lowballed him. They're like, the studio was like, 50,000, you'll do it. And Jeff Daniels was like, yeah, I'll do it.
But he was nobody
that's
at the
crazy.
Time.
That's crazy.
$50,000.
But that's because he was
getting... Like you're watching a $50,000 performance.
Yeah.
Most people make less than that in a year barely.
Yeah,
you know, and like, and the fact that makes you think that how much was he getting
Hollywood
paid for all of his
Everybody
other roles?
Right. Well, probably more after this, but
no, I know. But before his roles, like when he had $50,000, was he like, fuck yeah, or was he, you know what? Because
well, I mean,
Jim
like,
Carrey.
It could have been
the
50 plus Jim
the
Carrey.
I'm telling you, he was smart enough to know Jim Carrey's like the next big thing.
Well, back in that time,
Ace Ventura,
especially
then The Mask,
between
and
like early '90s to like
those
mid to late '90s, Jim Carrey
was all in
the
same
king
year. So,
of physical comedy.
So I'm pretty sure Jim Carrey. I think the record is like he had. I'm gonna slow myself down real quick. So like it was like 3 number one movies in a year.
Jim Carrey?
Yeah, so he had like Ace Ventura, The Mask, and then this right
probably
in,
the Cable
right
Guy.
December this came out.
Cable Guy didn't
Cable
do
Guy
as
was
well.
Right after this.
It didn't do as well in the theaters though. That was more of like a after the fact cult hit.
Yeah, Vince asking me, are you getting all emotional on this? I'm like, I guess he saw the passion and how
it's because
it was
it's so fucking
it's a brilliant
the
movie,
passion.
Vince.
If
the
you
passion.
Were shit in the 90s, you saw Dumb and Dumber and it sticks out to you.
It does. It does. And you know what? I almost broke a tear.
All right, Chuck, what's your scene?
My favorite scene is the scene where they get pulled over with Harlan Williams. And he's pissing in the beer bottles. And he just keeps going and going and going.
Yes.
And then Harlan Williams is like, just like, yeah, you take, exactly, yeah, that clicking noise he makes too.
The best
takes
part,
a sip
of
the, takes a swig
the
from
best
the
part,
piss.
Tic-tac, sir?
No! Because Harlan Williams honestly fell off the face of the earth after the 90s. And he was awesome.
Yeah, half-baked. He was the one that got arrested.
But what happened to him?
And half-baked, remember?
No, I mean, like, what happened to Harlan Williams? He disappeared.
I mean, what happened to that whole crew besides Brewer and Chappelle?
Jim Brewer was awesome.
Jim Brewer? What happened to Jim Brewer?
He had a couple of solid stand-ups.
He still tours here and there.
Yeah,
he was awesome.
All right.
He was a good
one. And then, what's your score?
Man.
To me, that's a comedy that holds up extremely well. like I said, outside of the soundtrack, it's pretty timeless. There's no unnecessary references that date it, so that it stays well relevant
other
even
than
today.
The soundtrack being in the 90s
and the new shows,
like everything else,
which honestly I like.
Me too.
Only because it's not because it's nostalgic, but because it also keeps it in that time frame to me.
Yes.
But that movie holds up extremely well. Kind of like I said before, it reminds me of the Zuckers, where that slapstick kind of comedy really just kind of holds up. It's hard to say because, like Dennis and I talked about before, with comedy, I kind of go up a little bit just because everybody underscores comedy.
You're right.
Right.
But this has dramatic moments, too, I'm telling you.
But it's one of the greatest comedies ever.
Yes.
It is.
It's a smarter comedy than people think.
I'll give it two ratings. Comedy scale, 9.7, because it stands up extremely to today, and it's still hilarious, even to somebody that might be, like, I don't know, 15 watching it now. It's still going to be hilarious.
Right. I can't wait till I can show my kids.
If you're watching it from a normal perspective,
right.
it's comedy.
It's a matter of time.
I would still probably give it an 8, to be honest.
Solid.
Red.
Solid movie, all the way through.
Solid as fuck. What do you want me to say?
It's your turn. You know, like, what is this? This is the 18th show.
It's hard,
I've been
right?
talking the whole time.
So talk some more.
I've never watched a movie more in my life.
You said you can quote it.
Oh my god!
I could literally.
Oh, by the way, I do want to go off a quick tangent. So we have a group chat on Facebook Messenger, which is all of us plus Jofer. Shout out to Jofer.
Bodega.
And it is the funniest fucking chat I've ever been a part of. Yeah. And I would love, and I want to see if anybody's interested. By the way, of this. Doing a Patreon thing where we set up one for the FooL and Friends so we can go to the movies and see things that we want to do like that, that we can bring better and more relevant reviews. But how would how would everybody feel about a Patreon of Red quoting Dumb and Dumber?
Oh, yo. No.
Word for word, Dumb and Dumber. I would pay. I would donate $10 for that. I would hear that.
Oh, wow.
Donating $10 for Red to do the whole movie.
I don't know what Patreon. I don't know how to start a Patreon, but I will for that.
If he can do Jeff Daniels, I'll do Jim Carrey, or vice versa.
Really?
Oh my god,
we should totally do
that. I would
fucking
do that.
Y'all can quote the whole movie.
I gotta do Jeff Daniels. Jeff Daniels is my character.
You can't. You have to fucking laugh. Every
and you gotta do that.
In the diner scene,
dude. That his laugh with the
when
he goes,
it gets me every time.
He goes, "Excuse me, Flo," which is a
Yes. Every fucking time, dude.
It's like, dude, I looked up. I didn't know what that meant when I first saw it, so I looked it up, and it's literally just a waitress in a show.
Yeah.
I didn't know what it was though when I first saw it.
Fucking hilarious.
So I was like, what is that reference? I thought it was gonna be deeper than that. It's like, nope, it's just a waitress.
How old were you when you saw it?
Dude, I don't remember, to be honest, but it was one of the first movies I remember like really taking in.
You saw it with your parents?
It's 94, right?
94.
You guys are all 85?
Yeah.
I was 87, so I was 7 years old.
Alright. Yeah. Oh man, damn. Yeah, some cool ass parents.
Young ass.
Only thing I remember specifically is my parents not letting me watch the scene with the your favorite scene where the
and then the whole scene ends with her opening
the headlines.
The headlines.
I remember my mom not letting me watch that. Then I remember her laughing.
Right.
Yeah, the good mom.
And then I watched it later on.
Shout out to Chuck's
mom. I love
your
mom. Shout out to my mom.
Shout out to Chuck's mom.
She shielded you.
Oh, she's awesome.
Oh,
my parents are awesome.
That's awesome.
And then I remember watching it as an adult. Thinking back to that, laughing even harder because I know that, you know.
Yes.
I love the way he looks at it. He's like,
dude. So,
some of the funniest scenes are when he's like just conjuring it in his mind, man.
Yeah.
When he beats the whole family and he lights his fort on fire. Come on.
Oh, yeah.
He's like doing like all these. He's like the hit of the party.
Yeah, that fucking.
He's like, wait, you guys think I'm funny? Watch fucking this.
You're right.
I'm not done.
Right, yeah.
Like in his mind, it's like him like impressing her.
Exactly.
Family.
Exactly.
Like,
yeah.
He was like, I know. Like, in his mind, he is fucking God. Like it was awesome. Like,
that show was great.
Yeah.
I'm surprised none of this is mentioned. By the way, the orange and blue suit.
Oh,
the suits are
I haven't got my turn yet.
It's like it's non-stop. Like there's nothing but jokes. The whole time,
it's,
they all make you fun.
So what's your scene?
Pretty timeless.
Me?
Let's yeah, because we're on you, and I got to go next.
I'm on me.
What did I say?
I don't know. Did the church?
So
I just said, the Harlan.
Okay,
Williams.
I'll go to the very end. Dude, the ending it doesn't get much better.
Yeah,
the fucking bus. The bus.
The ending.
Yeah, the ending. Where it's like, what do you? You think they're gonna go off like walk off together or whatever?
Right.
Like, he's not gonna get married. By the way. If he would have married Mary, what would her name? What would her name have been?
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
That's what he was saying when he was getting ready.
I didn't even know that.
Which, by the way, there's actually a song on the soundtrack called "Merry Moon" from a band.
Oh yeah, it's
from
Merry Moon. Is
it was a one hit wonder band called like Dead Eye Dick. Yes. I remember that specifically, and that song was awesome. Yeah. I used to love that song.
That's my favorite scene is the very ending where like they come up.
With the bus.
We're looking for two oil boys that can loop or oil us up after.
There's a town.
You're in luck. There's a town about 3 miles that way. I'm sure you'll find a couple guys there.
And then when he goes back, do you realize what you've done?
Hey! And he chases him down. You have to excuse my friend. He's a little slow. The town is back that way.
Dude.
He walks off triumphant like he fucking just like dropped the truth bomb. And
that fucking
like,
scene in
what
itself.
What the fuck is wrong with this dude?
Which, by the way, I want to ask you guys a question. Jim Carrey related. You ever see The Majestic?
Fucking amazing.
I did, but I only watched it once when it came out.
Surprisingly good.
Really? Fucking amazing.
Yeah, he's awesome in the movie.
I barely remember it, to be honest.
Bro.
He's really good in that
movie. Not get enough credit for that movie.
No, I totally agree. I was just curious.
It's just because people were so used to him being serious that they...
No, when he's serious, he's good.
I mean, so used to being funny that when he did a serious film, they were like, eh.
Well, Truman Show
thing
more
with Truman
comedy.
Show.
Majestic was a lot more serious.
Well,
no,
Truman Show was definitely way more dramatic. It had comedy elements.
Yeah.
But it was way more dramatic.
No, Majestic was a straight drama.
And then
it was a good movie. I was just curious, just because I honestly think Jim Carrey is underrated.
Yeah,
subject matter in The Truman Show is deep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
You're like, holy shit.
What, we should do it.
What's your score?
Truman Show
review.
Dude,
10 out of 10. There ain't no other score for
my man.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right,
so.
This is the first time.
I've watched it more than any other movie I've ever seen.
I would have to agree with the same thing.
I still watch it. I obviously know the jokes are coming, and I still laugh. I'll be by myself, and I'll laugh.
You don't have to be sad about it.
All right.
You don't have to be sad
about
it.
I'm always by myself. I'll be sitting there by myself watching it. I'm like laughing out loud like somebody's around or something. It's like,
yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, it's solid.
Yeah,
so
he smacks his sex doll. Hey, did you hear
that? Yeah, I smack my blow up doll. You see that?
Hey.
She's like, the cardigan.
Blow up doll.
The freaking cardigan. It's a cardigan. My name's Wilson, right?
That bitch deflated on me.
So
you don't know what's real comedy, goddammit.
That's my
look. I will say,
don't look at me.
That's so terrible.
It's the truth.
All right. It's definitely held up.
Favorite
scene? Well, I mean, we've all touched on.
When did you watch it? When you?
Oh,
how old were you?
I was probably like 13.
13.
12.
So we got
13.
7, 9. You don't remember?
You didn't watch it like when it first came out?
I had to wait till VHS.
I remember watching this in theaters.
I was 9, bro.
VHS.
9.
Yeah. 9
or
10, yeah.
Even when it came out to VHS, we didn't see it till later.
Yeah, I saw that the drive.
But the whole thing is just, front to back, it's hilarious. And I got to say, like, it's crazy because it's a longer comedy, which is rare. There's very few comedies that go almost 2 hours.
Young Frankenstein.
Yeah. Like I said, there's very few, though. Besides that one and a few others, I'm sure. But most of your comedies are like an hour and a half. And when I saw it, I was like, holy shit, like, this is almost 2 hours long. Like, I don't remember it being this long. But
we didn't even talk about the snow owls.
Yeah, there's a lot.
There's a lot we can talk about.
There's so much. Right, there's a lot. But we got a time constraint. Yeah. So,
there's so much.
There is. And I want to, honestly, like, that is my favorite scene is his fantasy.
His fantasy, yeah.
His daydream. But more so because of the fight. How it started
doggy
is first
bag.
Off the random the fucking bag, waiter yes. starts making out with her arm.
Yeah.
He's looking right in her eyes. He's looking right
and
right
I love
eyes.
How
yeah,
like
his eyes. Yeah.
How casual he is. He just backs out the seat, pulls it to the side of the table.
Like,
one
his
to
napkin.
Ten.
He takes his napkin. He goes.
Yeah, and like he gets up, he fucking knocks that dude out, fights the other guys. And I love how the whole time he's making these exaggerated noises.
Yeah. What? Ha ha!
And then the one like
noises.
Yeah, somewhat like Orientalish guy.
Totally you use that word?
Well, because I don't want to say he's Filipino. Don't tell me he's Korean.
Don't tell me
he's
Asian. You gotta say Asian. You gotta say Asian.
Oriental,
bro.
Asian is not the same thing.
No.
Fucking
no.
Is Oriental bad?
Oriental is like an Oriental rug.
Dude, you're bigot,
bro. I'm bigot?
You're talking about a rug.
Asian. Oriental. Okay, fine. Asian.
Just because they have the coronavirus right now.
You're an old white lady right now.
Holy ow, shit.
Shout out to Comic Doc. I am sorry,
he's one of those Oriental characters. I liked him in the picture show. He was very cute for the Oriental boy.
Is that where
oh
we're going?
God.
Is that where we're going?
I just
fucking this story.
That's where you went, mother.
I love it, man.
I didn't know it was bad. So sue me.
That's what I'm about, man.
Like, circle it back to the One Punch guy. We all make mistakes.
All right. Yeah. It was funny, though.
So, Asian. The guy. One sort of Asian guy. Because he might not even been Asian. He could have been like you. You.
I look Asian.
You look Patelian.
Patelian?
He's saying Indian, bro.
Indian. No, I know. I guess I'm like, I think about it. I guess that's Asia.
Well, I mean, you do. You have that as one of your set jokes.
I do. Yeah. I can play.
So could be Patel. You could be, you know, I can be Jesus. Santiago.
I can be Santiago. Know? I can be Jesus. I can be Patel.
Exactly.
I know.
So, like, you don't know what this cook is, but he comes out.
He's Asian.
The whole. Whoa!
The whole
thing, dude. That scene for me was peak Jim Carrey for me, because I was like that as a kid. Like I was that spastic and
fun fact, man.
Crazy.
I can see you as Jim Carrey,
bro. Like, that like I kid when, you not. I had the Ace Ventura walk down, like because I actually did him for Halloween.
Who wants to record that? And put on the
I want to say even
Facebook,
when I knew you in high school.
I don't. This is back in Ohio. Oh. Like I was middle school. And like they
you
have
to done that in high school, because I swear to God, since high school, I've pinned you as Jim Carrey.
Yeah, because like, I always
I think you've always had like that mannerism and
exactly
shit.
That's where I got a lot of my comedy ideas from, like the way I see things.
Yeah,
in that regards, bro, because of a lot of his shit.
I used to bend over and go, asshole mia,
dude,
oh sodomia. I used to do the whole fucking
thing.
Where's Fickle
that from? Fickle and Einbar. Fickle and Einbar.
By the way, my favorite Jim Carrey line of all time probably is when he's
Fickle and Einhorn.
And Ace Ventura 2, the Miami Dolphin. That's the first one. I'm sorry.
First one.
So the first one when he goes, when he's about to go in the bathroom, it's so stupid. I don't know why it stuck out with me as much as it did.
And he looks like that.
But he goes, if I'm not back in five... Or no, it's not that.
Oh.
If I'm not back in 5 minutes...
Wait a little longer.
Just wait longer.
I love when he exits, he's like, do not go in there.
Right.
That whole scene.
After he gets
me.
Beat up by the shark and get thrown around.
Dumb, but you've heard but a million times, flake. If I don't come back in 5 minutes, just go on without me or whatever.
That movie gets me
and the
every
way
time.
He fucking delivers that, man.
Yeah, but like...
Just wait longer.
That whole fight scene was just hilarious as fuck to me. I mean, the obviously the whole fantasy itself was just die-hard
right. It's just
comedy.
Over
but
the top. Yeah.
That part, for me, of the whole sequence there was just... That one was just fucking great. Hey, but,
how does he end it? How does he end it? Tell me how he ends it.
What, the fight?
The fight.
Where he fucking sticks
Kano.
His chest. And he takes Mortal it out. Kombat, he's like,
yeah. Yeah, exactly. Straight up Mortal Kombat.
And he puts it in the doggy bag and gives it to him.
Yeah,
God, that was good. So it still holds up very well for its time.
Hey, guys. Big gulps, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, you said line. Well,
I'll see you later.
Time.
Yeah, I do too.
It's an awkward conversation, like big gulp.
But it is.
See you later.
It is a solid tie between
you know
that
was improvised?
And the.
I believe that.
No, you know what else is
the old lady.
Huh? Oh,
I'm saying it was a tie for me between the fight scene and the old lady.
Oh yeah.
Because like he's like,
by a sweet
you
old
know, oh, it's yes. True what they say. You guys are still you like. Because I always forget about that scene for some reason. As much as I enjoy it, I tend to forget about it.
There's a lot of scenes,
and it always comes back, and I'm like, that's fucking right. Because he's trying to get the slut magazine.
Yes.
Wow. I'll be right back. Don't you go dying on me.
Yes. Dude, and the big ass cowboy hat.
Yes.
Like, where did you get the cowboy hat at that late
dude,
in the evening?
What's funny is they're like,
Get the goes, only get the essentials.
Only get the essentials. So, last of our money.
He walks yeah. out. Beef pinwheels. Whatever. Pinwheels. The ping pong.
The ping pong.
The ping pong.
The hat and
then
beer.
He wants to buy a porno mag.
Yeah.
Is that what it was? I thought it was a newspaper.
I thought it was a porno mag.
Well, it's like a both.
Oh,
it's like a little bit of both.
I didn't even pay attention. I just assumed it was a newspaper.
The wallet gets going and shit. God,
fuck.
Cripes. He said cripes. He goes, cripes.
We're gonna clear it out now. Alright.
The way he looks, bro.
Yes!
He's like, cripes! Like, while he's holding all his shit, dude. It's so funny.
So, I'm gonna give it a fucking 9. It's a 9.
9? Alright. Yeah.
I'll take 9 or above.
I'm taking a solid 9 on that.
Yeah, 8.8.
Well, but his.
I don't remember what I said, to be
honest. You had two scales.
9 point something.
Yeah, that's right. Comedy scale.
You better give it a 9 point or above, or I'm gonna fucking.
I don't even fucking remember. That was like 20 minutes ago. I don't even remember.
Alright, so. You picked last week.
It was like 8.9!
Last week.
I think we all picked One Punch Man for a while, so.
We'll pick
you got One Punch Man. Alright, so my turn this week. You know what? Because it's on Netflix and we can all watch it easily enough.
Oh, wait. We haven't done a score.
No, I gave my score. We all gave scores.
Hold on. Let me get some shout-outs here. There's a lot of people here.
Yeah, go for it.
There's Nathaniel. Shout-out to Nathaniel. Comic Doc. Dodo Love. Rio Paris is on the fucking show. He has his own show. Masturbation here. On Tuesday.
Sure. I Flow Highway Radio.
On Tuesday. Rio Paris.
Shout-out to all hilarious the Ohio motherfucker. Family.
I saw him at the Dunedin Brewery. Hilarious guy. Watch his show Tuesdays.
Shout out to Dunedin Brewery too.
You need to go on there.
I do
you
need
and,
to go on there.
You and Rio need to
shout out to Vince Liliana Everyone's over here showing some love. Thank you very much. Alright, sorry about that.
Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you all. Thank
so
you.
We love you.
I didn't pick last week. Yeah, I didn't pick last week at all. Yeah. So we're gonna do Nightmare on Elm Street, the reboot. We're doing the reboot.
It's on Netflix?
Yeah, it's on Netflix. Cool. It just got in like last week or whatever. So fuck it, we're gonna do 2010 Nightmare on Elm Street. Jackie Earl Haley. God, it's a fucking hell of a name to say.
Is that the director?
Rorschach. Wait. No, the actor. He plays Rorschach Freddy.
Seriously?
Yeah, you never watched the reboot of Nightmare on Elm Street?
I did not see the reboot. No, I'm not into it like you are.
Okay. It's a no, I knew that, but I figured you might have just out of curiosity.
I didn't know that, though.
Yeah, he plays Freddy Krueger in this. He does a pretty solid job, in my opinion.
He's awesome as Rorschach.
As a fan, I enjoyed the movie for what it was, but I understand why people didn't like it. But we'll get into that when we review it.
Keep an open mind when I watch it.
It's really good, though, honestly, for what it is. So we're going to do that. I wish Jofer would have answered the fucking phone!
Damn it, Jofer.
Because I was going to give him... We'll do Drive, because he wants to do Drive. So we'll do fucking Drive.
That's
with Ryan Gosling.
Okay.
And then the One Punch Man next 4 episodes. So yeah, that should really cover it. So all right. So for the next episode, 21st, we should be able to make our announcement then, I hope. But Nightmare on Elm Street reboot 2010. It's on Netflix. We're gonna do Drive, which is also on Netflix. Yeah, it's on Netflix. Ryan Gosling is the star of that one. And the next 4 episodes of One Punch Man. So if y'all want to participate, talk shit, huh? Y'all got picks last week or last episode. Oh, shit. So y'all have to wait till the next one.
We're also still looking for that third Apex player. Once again, if you guys
wanted to add third Apex player,
please.
We are going to start streaming Apex Sundays in the near future.
Sunday Apex sessions.
Yeah, Sunday Apex sessions with Bo and Chuck. Bo to FooL, Chuck doing the Apex thing. So if y'all want to join in, have some fun.
Please, we need a third.
Yeah, we really do.
Because that community is getting kind of toxic.
A little bit. So we're going to do our shout outs and close this shit up. Aruba.
Yes, sir.
What you got going on? Anything coming up? Any shout outs?
Nah, I got no shout outs. I got nothing coming out. I'm just doing some open mics. Trying to go hit up Monday and hit up Dunedin Brewery. Seems like a good crowd over there. So I'm going to do some work on some new material. That's over there.
Excellent brewery, by the way.
Yeah. They got some good stuff over there. So if you got anything to do on a Monday night, want to come to Dunedin Brewery, I'm gonna be out there slinging some jokes, and that's all I got.
All right, Chuck, any shout outs, any parting words?
I want to recommend another album since that seems to be my thing.
Fuck
a band called Slow Dive, one word.
Slow Dive,
British, kind of like sorry, I'm drawing a blank on the words here. They're a good British band, very airy, kind of out there, very good shoegaze. Definitely recommend it. Something if you want to just put on in the background, or if you smoke, listen to that while you smoke. It's fantastic. They put out the album specifically is called Slow Dive. It's self-titled. First album after like 23 years. By all means, listen to it. It's amazing.
All right. Anything else?
That's all I got.
All right. And Big Red.
Just shout out to the viewers, man, because I don't know if they heard it the first
time. Yes, thank you. Yeah. We love all of you.
Yeah, you know what?
800 and how much?
It was 874 when I checked earlier today at work. So y'all didn't hear this early in the show, but I was really appreciating you guys. We all are, like, for putting us up there. It's not a big deal for some of these other people who get, like, thousands and thousands like these Instagram thoughts and whatnot. We're not thoughts. I mean, we all kind of cute.
I got
right?
ass, though.
We got, you know, our thickness, you know what I'm saying? And we got the thick beardy man over here, and we got the dark guy over here. We got me.
We got the invisible man over here.
Looks white, but I'm Hispanic as
Hashtag
fuck.
Diversity, motherfuckers.
You know what I'm saying?
I look white, and I'm Hispanic.
Right! So, yeah, but no, for real, we really appreciate y'all guys. Like, 874 was our record as of now.
I am honored and humbled. Thank you.
Yeah, like, the fact that y'all are doing that, so share it.
5 seconds, the whole show, whatever it is. Thank you for just tuning in.
And please like and share. Please like and share.
And when I tell you,
if you like the show, please, that helps us grow.
Keep an eye out. May, for all those that do watch and pay attention and listen in Tampa, we're going to have an event in May. It's going to be a thing. It's a birthday event.
Come on out.
So if you have a birthday in May and you want to have some fun, we're going to have a little shindig.
If your birthday is in May, come on out.
It's a party for you, too.
We'll pull you up on the stage and embarrass you and wish you a happy
birthday. If you want.
Absolutely.
Shout out to the Geminis.
So we're going to... we're still tweaking the details.
And the Tauruses.
But once... hopefully by next episode, we should have 100% able ability to let you all know exactly what's going down. You're not going to want to miss it. It's going to be fucking good time.
And please help us break 1,000 views.
Yeah.
Please.
That would be our next goal.
Monumental for
share
us.
Your,
thank you.
Share it to your friends. Share it to your employees. Exactly. Co-workers. Everybody.
You know. Let's show that these Instagram thoughts ain't got shit on us.
We
got content.
We're a wholesome bunch.
I don't know why I'm digging at the thoughts. Enough. I'm sorry. Like, thoughts y'all deserve.
Unless you're like Bobby and Blake and David and y'all motherfuckers need help.
Yeah.
Professional help.
Take your hands off the dick.
Y'all need Jeebus.
Y'all need like some kind of religion.
Take your hands off the dick and fucking
or keep
call
it
somebody.
On the dick. Who cares?
So
just don't put that on Facebook.
Just you know, yourself.
As we tend to do, I'm gonna play us out with a song here by a local band.
Ariana Grande.
She's not local.
She's local.
And I don't know. We don't do that here.
We don't do that here.
Oh, fuck, what the hell you think this is?
Can't afford to pay her royalties.
Right? That should be shut down in fucking minutes.
Shout out to Pi, by the way.
Yeah, right? So, yeah, we're going to play a song by House of I.
Knew it.
Yes.
Shout out to House of I. They're a fucking great local band. Check them out. We're going to play Life by them. And thank you for tuning in. As always, this is Boat Fool, capital L. Well, thank y'all for tuning in, liking, sharing, subscribing, any of that shit that you do.
Please.
All of it.
I love it.
Everything.
Love all y'all.
We love all of you.
Love you guys.
Thank you guys.
Thank you guys.
Shit.
This is awesome.
I really appreciate
just
it.
Just being a part of this is awesome.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
I love y'all. Still
you're talking to the Rolex wearing, diamond ring wearing, kiss stealing, woo, wheeling, dealing, limousine riding, jet flying, son of a gun, and I'm having a hard time holding these alligators down.